Space, the final frontier. These are the voyages of the Starship.
When this legendary title sequence with its groundbreaking special effects was first broadcast in 1967, nobody had a clue Star Trek would transform TV and popular culture forever.
To boldly go where no man has gone before.
It not only turned Spock, Sulu, Captain Kirk, and Uhura into the galaxy's greatest superstars, but over the next four decades grew into a global phenomenon.
Every single episode discusses some kind of a significant issue of the 60s.
Attracting legions of the most fanatical followers and even inventing a brand new language. But Star Trek is not just the greatest sci-fi series in history. For Trekkies around the world, it's a way of life, and they're loving it. My mission is to bring back Star Trek, the original series.
Paris, do you have Leonard Nimoy's email?
Can we beam my plums in, please?
Jekyll!
Mr. Spock has just made me this coffee.
It's not going to be easy. I've got just 10 days to reunite them all and recreate my favourite ever scene.
Sniff it, Gorn! Sniff it!
I'm trying to boldly go where no fan has gone before. All I've got so far is Klingons on my starboard bow. Ooh, Captain Kirk.
I've flown halfway across the planet to Los Angeles to set up my mission control for this challenge of Uranus-sized proportions.
This is quite simply the biggest TV show ever.
I'm already feeling the pressure big time because my targets are all true television legends.
Historical significance, this lady. Plus the fact she's gorgeous. Ah!
Reuniting them will be tricky because the Enterprise crew famously did not get on.
Infighting? Was there infighting? It was a shitstorm in space!
Particularly Mr. Sulu and the captain with the dodgy barnet.
Take one good hard look at that hairline and you tell me that that hair's not real. I'm a man who knows hair, and that hair is hair. It may be from a horse, but it's hair.
I need to get cracking if I'm going to discover what went on behind the scenes and how in just three series, Star Trek changed the world.
We're going intergalactic. Let's take it to warp factor 4. Let's fly.
In the late 60s, the human race was on the verge of visiting new planets for the very first time.
Liftoff. We have a liftoff. 32 minutes past the hour. Liftoff on Apollo 11.
With Apollo 11, the dream of interplanetary space travel has finally become a reality.
While the world was gripped with space fever, film and TV's cosmic journeys were still light years behind. None of them could capture the sense of wonder and excitement about the final frontier. But then along came Star Trek, the ultimate intergalactic adventure.
Do anything you think necessary to protect the ship.
With the foxiest crew in the cosmos, futuristic gadgets, and hardcore man versus alien combat. Go on, have him! Don't touch his hair, though! Getting to the big two is going to be tough, so I've got a team of stalkers tracking Captain Kirk, aka William Shatner, across Hollywood, and have a man undercover outside his private office.
You get a whiff of Shat. Okay? The minute you think you smell Shat, call me.
An even more crucial target is Spock.
This is the man that's integral. This is the man for me that will bring all of this together.
The middle of the earth in the land of Shire is a brave little hobbit whom we all admire.
The pointy-eared Vulcan is notoriously elusive, and the only thing I've dug up on him so far is this howler.
Why would he do that?
With Spock still a work in progress, it's time now to focus on all the stories of behind-the-scenes bust-ups.
Right from the very beginning, there was aggro between this man and this man. Now, why didn't these two get on? I want to know from him. Let's go and find Mr. Sulu.
We know George is getting married in a couple of days, and he's so busy making final arrangements, he's impossible to tie down. but an insider has told us when he's due to visit his wedding venue, and I've come up with a ruse for the best way to get myself in and snare the Sulu.
How many do you want to do?
Maybe, is that half a dozen maybe?
Is that good? I love this bit.
Having piped my cream all over George's face, it's time to deliver my tasty treats.
Right, we are outside the Japanese American Museum. George Takei, aka Mr. Sulu from Star Trek, is somewhere inside this building. I've put George Takei's, Takei, I've put his face on a cake. How can I possibly go wrong?
I have no idea. I have absolutely no idea where I am. Where's George Takei? Takei? Are you sure it's Takei? I would say Takei. I'm looking for Mr. Takei.
We do not allow anybody in this area without permission from the public relations.
Yeah. A flash of my buns helps me get past security.
Okay, but I'll...
Yeah.
You may pass.
Thank you so much.
Brilliant.
Thank you.
All I need now is to get to the main man and butter him up with my package.
So just go in, isn't it?
George Takei. Mr. Takei. I'm so sorry to interrupt. I'm really sorry to interrupt. My name is Justin Lee Collins. I'm from Channel 4 in England. I'm making a show...
I can tell by your accent, yes.
Yes. I'm making a show called Bring Back Star Trek.
Bring Back Star Trek?
Yes.
A show called that?
Yeah.
Well, I'm associated with Star Trek, but no, I'm not familiar with your show.
Well, it's a new show. No one's ever done this before.
Oh, I see.
I would like, if possible, to sit and have a talk with you about your part in Star Trek.
Oh, well, we have a meeting going here.
I've made cakes. Every meeting should have a good bun.
Oh, it's, look at it's that. A bit,
look, George, I've put your face on a bun. We do like
you
a
bring
drink.
Your own food.
Would you like to try one?
Well, I'd love it.
They're
yes.
delicious.
Shall I bite into my chin?
Please. Is this against health and safety? Are these all right to eat, these cakes?
Mm.
Is that good?
Mm. Delicious.
Would you sign my captain's log to agree to take part in the show?
I'd like to read what I'm signing.
It's a brown log. That's all it is.
You just want my autograph on
it? Yes, please.
Oh, I'd be happy to.
This seals the deal. George Takei, everybody.
We're lucky.
Oh, my.
Thank you.
You have a fuzzy, fuzzy kiss.
It's soft, though, isn't it?
Coming up...
You'll get no help from me.
George won't help me pull off William Shatner.
You're not going to help me find him.
So I try to penetrate Captain Kirk's ring of steel all on my own.
They want some meat. They want some man meat, and they're ready for me.
I've flown over 5,000 miles to LA to bring back the greatest sci-fi series ever. I've used my creamy buns to nail Mr. Sulu. Now I want to pump him for information about the turbulence on board the Starship Enterprise.
George Takei, everybody, aka Mr. Sulu from Star Trek.
When Series 1 of Star Trek began, there wasn't just turmoil in space.
The year 1967 was a year of violence, of war, of riots, of disaster.
Conflict raged in Vietnam. The Berlin Wall was tearing East and Western Europe apart. And America and Russia were on the verge of all-out nuclear war. Star Trek's creator, Gene Roddenberry, wanted to show an optimistic future of peace and unity and broke new boundaries by casting a multicultural crew working together for a common cause, including Sulu, one of the first positive representations of an Asian man on TV.
I recognized right away it was a breakthrough role for me because, you know, most Asian or Asian American roles at that time were rather stereotypical and one-dimensional. And usually with an accent.
Is this another one of your connections?
No connection. Maybe long time ago friend.
Here was a character who was a part of the leadership team, carrying his weight, contributing to the success of the whole Enterprise.
Mr. Sulu, lock in phaser tracking controls.
Phaser's locked in, sir.
No accent. It was a thrilling description of an Asian American character.
Give up your hate!
Star Trek featured morality tales welcome like this one to hit the message home about living in harmony.
Listen to me. You both must end up dead if you don't stop hating.
While on screen, Captain Kirk was doing his best to promote good intergalactic relations, behind the scenes, William Shatner was winding up some of his shipmates.
I hear tell that you and Mr. Shatner didn't really see eye to eye necessarily.
I mean, he's a high energy guy, but he's also a high ego guy. And Captain Kirk was the ideal role for him. I mean, when his nibs showed up on the set and saw that they were setting up for a close-up on me, he would take the director off and have a whispered conference on the corner of the set. And the director would come back and he'd be changing the setup. It would be on the captain and I would be an off-screen voice. You know, his argument was that his reaction was what was important, not the person saying what he was reacting to. Maybe that might have been an appropriate decision, directorial decision, once or even twice. But when it happens consistently, and it happens with everybody else, you know. And some people were a little bit reticent about speaking up, but, you know, I'd like to hold my turf.
In this classic episode, a foreign body transforms Sulu into a sword-wielding maniac and he goes on a rampage, brandishing his fearsome weapon.
You terrorized the Enterprise.
That was great fun. At long last, I got unchained from that console.
You look a man possessed.
Well, I was supposed to be possessed by that virus.
Mr. Liu!
Threatening Captain Kirk came easy for George, as off-screen, he was being wound up by one thing in particular.
He never pronounced your name correctly, is that true?
Yes. And, you know, I'd been trying to pound it into his noggins, couldn't succeed, and so I thought, well, there's a way of doing that. I said, Bill, it's pronounced Takei. It rhymes with toupee. I thought that would do it. No. It just lies there, and he still says Takai.
If it was me, I would have started calling him Mr. Shitner. What do you call Shitner? He's just in there.
Thank you. I'll attribute the advice to you,
take
Justin.
It, George. It's yours.
Bill Shitner. Yes, because shat is past tense. Shit is present.
Oh, I love that.
Oh, I love it. I love it.
Is there a chance that I'm going to track him down? Is this going to be difficult, do you think?
You'll get no help from me.
You're not going to help me find him.
Mm-mm.
In any way.
Mm-mm.
George has surprised me with tales of Shatner's power on set, and if I want to get close to him, I obviously need to show him some respect.
I won't mention it. I won't mention it. I know it can be embarrassing. I won't say a word about it. Just talk to me. Dear Shats, I'll strike that. Mr. Shatner.
I'm throwing everything I've got at this one, but it's an uphill struggle trying to get my hands on the captain.
I can guarantee that I would not mention the syrup. I would never do that. I wouldn't mention that. No, I will not do it. Oh, okay. Oh, shall I call back later?
As a classically trained actor, William Shatner had his talents pushed to the limit, playing the man in charge of the Enterprise. From going stark raving bonkers, to enduring a terrifying tussle with a lizard in my favourite scene ever. But most challenging of all, keeping a straight face while Leonard Nimoy got jiggy. Getting the shats was always going to be challenging, and as all else has failed so far, I've decided to take affirmative action.
This could be the final straw. Rocking up to Captain Kirk's. So he's got a dog? You brought a gun. Did you bring the guns?
This part of LA is home to lots of big stars.
Excuse me, is that Shatner's place?
And as armed security regularly patrol the area, I need to tread very carefully.
Can you see CCTV? Yeah, in the trees, I got it. The red one. Just wave there. All right, we're all friendly. I come in peace. I come in peace. Hello there, I'm here to see Bill. It's about bringing back Star Trek. Would you mind telling him that Justin's here? Honestly, he is expecting me. Is he in at the moment?
It soon becomes obvious I'm not a welcome visitor at Shatner Mansion.
Please. This is definitely his house. There's a guard dog, I can see it. Oh, shit. And there's two of them as well. Look at them. Can you see them? Right. Look. Oh, fuck me. There are two of the biggest, meanest looking dogs that I've ever seen. And there they are. I can just see their little sphincters. Tight and twitching because honestly they want some meat. They want some man meat and they're ready for me. Because I'll tell you what, there's a lot to chow down on there. Shit. Okay, come on, because that gate's going to open in a minute and those dogs are going to come out. And I'll tell you what, they want balls.
So I can't chat to Kirk about his bust ups with Sulu just yet. Now I need to focus on the next big drama which rocked the Enterprise.
Behind the scenes, it was kicking off right from the start. Then halfway through series one, this woman, Yeoman Janice Rand, was sensationally sacked. She was one of the original four big characters. The leading lady of the Enterprise. She was dropped, cut loose, set adrift into space. Why? I need to know. But tread carefully, you boys. Look at those eyes. Stick to the roads. Don't stray onto the moors.
In the old days of sci-fi, women were often no more than weak and hysterical alien fodder, and all they showed off was the power of their lungs. But then came the scantily dressed sirens of Star Trek, women with attitude and power who sexed up the schedules with their scandalous fashions, the likes of which had never been seen on TV before.
Why don't you go chase an
Janice asteroid? Rand was the fox in a skirt so mini, it was rumoured her little red number was responsible for raising hemlines around the world.
How about that?
She not only turned on all the crew, but most of the viewers, and even the flowers in her lady garden.
Hello, Beauregard. How are you today, darling?
We've been investigating Grace Lee Whitney, and know she went off the rails for a while after getting the boot. So I need to approach this one with sensitivity and tact.
And tits. Yeah, that's nice.
We've got a trap set and waiting, but it's vital I ambush the right woman. So I'm using the latest computer aging technology to get an idea of what she looks like 40 years on.
That is amazing. This woman's got nowhere to hide.
Just received a tip-off from our insider that a female matching Grace's description has been spotted at a fancy mall in the heart of Beverly Hills. I need to get to her sharpish before she exceeds her credit limit.
Well, here's the thing, obviously Grace Lee Whitney is going to be a lady of a certain age, so I'm not looking for a young woman, I'm looking for a hot older lady. You wouldn't happen to be Grace Lee Whitney, would you? Didn't have a little thing with Captain Kirk. Woman over there? Is your name Grace?
Yeah.
You weren't in Star Trek? Grace Lee Whitney, where are you?
I've scoured every floor in the mall, but there's no sign of a woman who spent all her time in space under William Shatner.
Were you in Star Trek?
But just when I think my insider needs their eyes testing, I finally spot someone with a whiff of Star Trek about her.
Are you Grace Lee Whitney? Are you serious? Did you play Yeoman Janice Rand in Star Trek? Were you Kirk's love interest?
Yes, yes.
Grace Lee Whitney, a.k.a. Yeoman yes, Janice Rand. My name is Justin Lee Collins. I'm from Channel 4 Television in the UK. Ooh. I'm trying to bring back Star Trek. I'm trying to reunite the cast. Grace, would you be prepared when you finished your shopping to have a sit down with me, nice and relaxed, and talk about your years on Star Trek?
Where would you do this?
My hotel.
Your hotel.
Yeah, or your hotel, or wherever.
I don't know if I could go to your hotel.
I'll be very respectful. I'm a very respectful man.
Can I bring a friend?
Yeah, do you want to bring a friend?
I don't know if I trust you.
Bring a friend.
But you're very cute.
Thank you very much indeed. So this is a yes?
All right.
Grace Lee Whitney, everybody. Woo!
Gene Roddenberry wanted Star Trek to portray women in a more positive light and made the radical decision of putting Yeoman Rand on an equal footing with her male crew members. Uncharacteristically for the time, she was a strong woman knocking. Who didn't take it lying down from her men.
Don't ever lock your door on me again, Janice. I love you.
I'll lock it when I please.
Back on this ship, I used to try to get you to look at my legs.
But taking it lying down is exactly what she wanted off Captain Kirk, and for Grace, it wasn't hard to get into character.
Look at my legs.
You had quite a flirtatious relationship with Kirk, didn't you?
He was supposed to be in love with the ship. And I was basically in love with him. They wanted me to like him, but don't be so obsessed. Well, we couldn't help it. We had a chemistry.
You had a chemistry off camera as well, off screen?
Oh, everywhere, sure.
Did you ever have a thing with...
No, I didn't ever do anything. I just wouldn't put out.
Come here, James. Don't fight me. Don't fight me, James.
Yeoman Rand only lasted 8 episodes, but appeared in one of the series' most shockingly memorable scenes, where Kirk splits into good and bad versions of himself, and bad Kirk tries to rape her.
Just a minute!
Shatner's intense performance left a lasting impression on the viewers, and also on Grace.
He beat me up. I was black and blue for days.
Are you kidding me?
No, I was black and blue because I did all my own stunts.
What nobody knew was that the injuries picked up in this scene were made worse due to the pressure to fit into her little red dress.
Gollister's back! Gollister's back!
I was on diet pills trying to stay thin. So I was very thin.
Why were you taking diet pills?
Well, they wanted you to fit into the uniforms. And I couldn't fit into it as well as they wanted me to. So I went on amphetamines to stay thin.
You started hurting me. I had to fight you.
Later in the same episode, Rand tells the good Kirk about the attack. The tears were real, but the motivation for them totally unexpected.
Look at my face.
They said, action. And I'm looking into the camera. Bill comes up from behind the camera and slaps me right across the face.
He hit you in the face?
Yes. He wanted to cause a reaction so that I would do the scene well.
After the take, Grace, did he apologize? Did he
No.
How did you react to that afterward? What did you say to him?
Well, it actually threw me off base. I probably would have done a better scene if he hadn't done that. It shocked me.
Thank you, Captain.
But Grace was in for an even bigger surprise. After just 8 shows, Star Trek's leading lady made a sudden, unexplained disappearance from the ship in this her last ever scene.
They'll leave orbit as soon as the Caridian Company is aboard the ship.
They did this because they wanted William Shatner to have romances in each episode with a different woman. Because for William Shatner, for Captain Kirk to be stuck with one woman on the whole series was not good for him. You know, it wasn't good for the audience. So that's what they told me. So I was written out. The other thing that was also said, well, there were 2 blondes and 1 black girl. Nichelle was almost an extra. She wasn't, you know, an important character. But the black girl could not be written out. Political. Everything's political in America, you know. We're politically correct. That's why we're going down the tubes. So one of the blondes had to go. The other blonde was engaged to Mary Jean. So guess who went?
As a direct result, Uhura went on to become both the female lead and one of the most popular characters in the show's history. But for Grace, her unexpected departure had a devastating effect.
When I lost the show, I just about killed myself, yeah. So I just drank. Rather than kill myself, I just drank. That's what we do, you know, we drink to get rid of pain. I was really mad.
Because you were bitter?
Yeah, bitter. Oh, my God. God, was I bitter.
I'm blown away by Grace's revelations, and it's vital I now find the woman who came to prominence as a result of her departure. Nichelle Nichols, aka Uhura. The clock is ticking, and as Captain Kirk is becoming a distant hope, I also need to start making headway on securing Mr. Spock. Coming up, I'm gagging to get up close and personal with the gorgeous Uhura.
Nice and clean. Ready to do some stalking?
You're Walter Koenig!
And I've got my own hunt for Red October trying to pin down Chekhov.
Worst Russian accent in the history of television? I'm not having it. Droid, Sammy!
I'm on a mission to bring back the greatest sci-fi series in history, Star Trek. My creamy buns have tempted George Takei, aka Sulu, to make some kind of appearance at my reunion.
Mm. Is that good?
Mm. Delicious.
But Yeoman Janice Rand is unavailable.
Live long and prosper.
Thank you, please.
Yes, yes, yes.
Kirk is proving highly elusive.
The bagel rooms worked.
I'm trespassing.
I even tried breaking into the Boston Legal Studios, only to find I'm running out of luck, and fast.
After all that, he's not even there.
But my research team has been making good progress on Spock, and if I can get a Russian man to put a word in, I could have myself a date with the Vulcan. Now I need to train my sights on Uhura, the woman who, after Yeoman Rand was sensationally sacked, became Star Trek's first lady. For days, I've been keeping a close eye on Uhura, and know she's so busy she declines most Star Trek invitations. I've already been turned down by her people, but I finally worked out a way to seduce the woman who made TV history.
Did you not see my lady?
Back in the 60s, the most prominent black faces on TV were white ones covered in boot polish, and women on screen took a background role, often typecast as bimbos or eye candy.
I'm connecting the bypass circuit now, sir.
The role of Uhura was considered totally radical for the time.
Speed is essential, Lieutenant.
But network execs only agreed to it as the show was set in the 23rd century, when they thought there might be a better chance of racial equality.
It's very delicate work, sir.
I can think of no one better equipped to handle it, Miss Uhura. Please proceed.
We're on our way to get Nichelle Nichols, a.k.a. Uhura, from Star Trek. Now, she made history because she took part in the first on-screen interracial kiss when she snogged William Shatner, a.k.a. Captain James T. Kirk. I'm hoping if I can find her, she'll be up for kissing me. Think she's ever kissed a Bristolian before, Sam? Once you've had Bristol, Sam, you never go back.
To lure Nichelle into my grasp, we've told her a bit of a fib, that I'm opening a Walk of Fame in England and want to honour her with her very own star.
Just stretch right up, forget health and safety. This bunting has to look the shit.
The invitation's in the post. Now all we have to do is pray she turns up for the ceremony.
Hopefully Nichelle Nichols will be here shortly, along with some Uhura superfans. We've got an area sectioned off for them. We've got some bunting all along the wall. And we've got some clay, where hopefully she's going to put her hands into this clay. Who's done that? It's not a bad job, actually.
I've roped in some genuine adoring fans to make everything look totally legit. Now all I have to do is wait. But she's already 10 minutes late, and I'm starting to wonder if she'll be sticking anything into my wet concrete. I've been dreaming about her coming for days, but just when it looks like that fantasy is about to become my worst nightmare, I finally get an eyeful of what looks like Uhura's entrance.
Thumbs up, we're good to go. Okay, let's go. Okay, ready?
Oh, it's wonderful you to come out. Oh, okay.
We've got to go around the back way. It's Nichelle Nichols.
Now I'll put my hand
in
it, right?
Hi. Oh, I'm sorry, sorry. All right, guys. She's through here, okay. Nichelle Nichols! Nichelle Nichols! Nichelle? Hello, I'm so sorry. My name is Justin. I've come all the way from the UK, from England. This is not about a Bristol Walk of Fame. I'm making a show for Channel 4 television.
Honey, I'm putting my hands in the...
I know, but Nichelle, you don't have to do that. You can take your hands out of the clay, you can wash your hands now, it's fine. I'm doing a show called Bring Back Star Trek. You are Uhura. And I was just wondering if that maybe once you've got cleaned up, you would agree to sit down and have a conversation with me.
I'm not sure I want to.
Well, please, please, I'm a nice man, and I've come a long, long way.
Oh, you mean you're responsible for this?
I'm responsible for this. This is all me. Water, Nichelle, we have water. Do you want to dunk your hands in there? Thank you. I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. Would you sit and talk with me about Star Trek? Please. You're so beautiful. Please. I'll do anything for you.
Anybody that go to this much trouble for an interview.
Thank you so much. Nichelle Nichols, everybody.
How many roads must a man walk down before you call him a man?
Less than 50 years ago, racial tension was rife in many parts of the world. In South Africa, the policy of apartheid was gaining ground.
We cannot mix
with the lower nations, unless they are cultivated and educated and so on.
While in the US, the African American population was fighting for basic human rights.
The answer, my friend, is blowing in the wind. The answer is blowing in the wind.
Excuse me, Captain Kirk.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Scott.
What a charming negress.
In the late 60s, many people had never seen a black person on TV. Gene Roddenberry used Uhura to provoke debate about one of the biggest social taboos of the era.
But why should I object to that term, sir? You see, in our century, we've learned not to fear words.
These were incredible times. In 66, we were fighting for freedom. Police dogs and hoses being turned on to these people who came to march for freedom, to walk on a sidewalk without getting out of the way for a white person.
My fears would fade, and now they're making me tremble.
Roddenberry pushed the envelope even further with this highly contentious scene.
I am not afraid.
No American TV drama had dared to feature an interracial kiss before. But it was nearly someone else who got to make history with Uhura.
Actually, the scene was, original scene, was written between Uhura and Spock.
Really?
Yes. Bill saw it and said, oh no, if anybody's going to get to kiss Uhura, it's going to be me. I mean, Kirk.
The kiss was considered so risky, the director had second thoughts about filming it. What the audience never knew was that Shatner used his power to make it happen.
And so Bill kisses me. And the director goes, cut, cut, cut! He says, Bill, what are you doing? Bill said, I'm following the script. He says, they embrace and they kiss. You can't get us not to kiss. The director goes back and he's just unnerved by this. He says, fine, I have the solution. Shoot it both ways.
Worried that the controversial kiss would be dropped, Shatner took matters into his own hands.
As he doesn't kiss me, he looked up into the camera and crossed his eyes.
He ruined the tape.
The director was so happy we did not kiss. He never saw it until the next day.
That's brilliant.
And that's how the first interracial kiss got on television.
Do you think there is a chance that we could maybe... I mean, you know, things aren't quite so controversial now. We could maybe recreate that kiss.
Please.
I love you.
You know what I was thinking about?
Yeah.
I'm not sure if it would have the same effect.
It would. It would, I promise you.
Studio bosses remained nervous about Uhura's role, and she became little more than a glorified telephone operator.
Ship. Healing frequencies open, sir.
Frequency open and clear, sir?
I've repeatedly tried on every healing frequency, sir.
These unchallenging script lines left Nichelle frustrated.
The only thing that really pissed me off was they would show me the original script in which I had these wonderful roles in, and only thing would be cut would be my role, because the studios simply wanted to get rid of me.
Why?
A woman, number one, and a black woman at that. That finally hit them, she's part of the command crew.
Thanks to an insider, Nichelle was tipped off that a lot of fan mail was being hidden from her.
He said, we just thought you'd like to know that you get an awful lot of fan mail. Why don't you come and get it? I said, I get my fan mail. He said, no, we've got bags of fan mail for you. Everybody gets great fan mail, but you and Leonard and Bill... get the most.
Because of the shoddy treatment, Nichelle decided to leave, and this would have been her last ever scene if it hadn't been for a chance meeting with civil rights leader Martin Luther King.
He began to talk about what Star Trek meant to the civil rights movement. And I said, I'm really going to miss my co-stars. And he says, what do you mean? What are you talking about? And I said, oh, I told Mr. Roddenberry that I'm going to leave the show. He said, you cannot. What you are doing and how you're portraying your character, you've changed the face of television forever. For people who don't look like us, they see us for the first time as we should be seen.
as human beings, as equals. And I went back to Gene Roddenberry on Monday morning and I told him what Dr. King said and that if you wanted me to stay. And tears came out of his eyes. And he said, God bless Dr. Martin Luther King. Somebody knows what I'm doing. He's exactly right.
I'm gonna have a little get together. Would you come to my little Star Trek party?
If I come, it's got to be very special because Star Trek is very special to me.
Do you mean in terms of special effects? Because I can get special effects. I'll make it very special.
Okay.
Thank you so much.
You're very welcome.
Oh, there you go. Nichelle Nichols, everybody. Woo!
Uhura wanting a climax to remember has inspired me to mount something big. I'm not just going to put on a reunion, I'm going to recreate my favourite ever scene from the series with all the bells and whistles.
Yeah. This is it. We are going upmarket. This is the kind of Hollywood shit that I've been talking about. CGI. You know what I'm saying, Sammy? CGI? Do you know what that means? Neither do I, but I want it. Okay, magic me up some of that stuff. Drop it in. Drop it in. That's rubbish. This is the best we can do? Geez, this is the best we can do. The floor's shaking, the walls are moving. It's like prisoner cell block H. Do I look like vinegar tits? This is Star Trek. I want the future now. I want tomorrow today. Uhura asked for a special ending. And she's gonna get one. Right between the eyes.
After so many major problems from the beginning of Star Trek, there was a change in the show's fortunes towards the end of Series 1, with the introduction of a brand new element. Klingons rocked up for the very first time in this classic scene. It was a landmark moment because arguably nothing else has had such a powerful influence on the show's popularity and impact on popular culture.
You are now subjects of the Klingon Empire. You will find there are many rules and regulations. They will be posted. Violation of the smallest of them will be punished by death.
As Klingons developed their look and their very own language, they became a phenomenon. Practicing Klingalingus on each other allowed Trekkies to bond together in their own private universe. Combined fan power is such a crucial part of the show's history that next on my hit list is a Star Trek legend, Dr. Mark Cochran, the creator of Klingonese. We've heard Mark is about to leave Tang, but we've tracked him down to an address in Los Angeles. He's never met me before and knows nothing about my mission, but I'm hoping he'll spare me 10 minutes before he gets on a plane to talk about the fastest growing language in the world.
People all around the world have started learning this language. I mean, people have translated the works of Shakespeare into Klingon.
Are there people who can go through their entire day just speaking Klingon?
Yes, yes. At these conventions where they get together, the Klingon Language Institute conventions, for the entire day, for the entire length of the convention, they will speak nothing but Klingon to anybody, including waiters and hotel staff, and they talk to each other in Klingon all day long, and if someone addresses them in English, they'll answer back in Klingon.
This man quit his job as a tax collector to teach Klingon and land the chicks.
Daklage par daklage air.
What does that mean?
Your place or mine.
Oh, I see. Has it ever worked?
Not really.
Mark, are there Klingon swear words?
Yeah, there are Klingon swear words. There have to be. The Klingons are mean and tough and grouchy.
So what is the Klingon for fuck?
It's Khutvak.
What, one more time?
Khutvak.
Khutvak.
Vak. Yeah.
Khutvak. Is that it?
Yeah.
Khutvak.
Khutvak.
Right, let me just throw these out there and you tell me if there is a Klingon translation. I'm saying, in English, cock cheese. You're saying, in Klingon,
tongue shot.
That's cock cheese.
Yeah.
Mark, suck my balls.
Konvat.
And you're able to just throw out a translation. Where is that coming from?
I'm making up the syllables, but I'm translating in my mind. What I'm doing is translating the concept.
You're translating the concept of sucking my balls?
In Klingon.
Oh, man!
The Klingons would never do that.
I know, but fuck it! Season one was riddled with problems. And I mean riddled. Season two, things went from bad to worse with the introduction of this man. New face, new accent, new hair. Chekhov, a.k.a. Walter Koenig. The handsome Ruski with the mop top was drafted in to capture younger female viewers and reflect the space race. But his arrival produced a cold war on board the spaceship, notably with certain male members of the crew. We're going to his local park, which is in North Hollywood. We know he likes jogging, so I've got my trainers on, I've got my shorts on, and I'm ready to run. I'm ready to run down Chekhov. Despite the onboard hostilities, our insider has informed us Walter loves talking about his time on the show, so this should be a complete doddle. There's absolutely no one here. I'm looking for a single jogger in an empty park. I can see signs of life over there, should we go over that way? Anyone seen Chekhov? He runs here, apparently. Walter? You weren't Chekhov on Star Trek, were you? My cruising for an older man in a public park is getting me all sorts of dodgy looks. Could you spot me? Oh, man, that's it. More. Yeah. I'm starting to worry I could be done under the laws of indecency. I've come up with a ruse so I don't end up on the wrong end of a copper's truncheon. There you go. Can I interest you in an energy drink or a banana? There you go. That's my pleasure. No. My refreshment stall is already pulling in the punters. Hi, how you doing?
Hi, thanks. How are you?
We're good. Would you care for some refreshments? It's a hot day. You're running. Oh! And I would come in. I'd go for the plums, though. That's why I took some dirty. Yeah. I'd go for the plums. Give me a Vulcan high five. Stop by again.
I will.
Oh, shit. So I go back to school. But after an hour of waiting, there's still no sign of Chekhov. That tastes like shit. Energy drink, banana. You're Walter Koenig.
Hey.
Banana, Walter Koenig. Can you just stop for one moment? You are, please. Walter, my name is Justin. I've come all the way from Channel 4 Television in the UK. I'm doing a show about Star Trek. It's called Bring Back Star Trek. Please stop, I'm going to be sick. I promise you I'll be sick. I can't run. You're Walter Koenig.
Yeah.
I've travelled all this way to try and track you down. Walter.
No guns or anything.
There's no guns. This is my crew. Say hello, everybody. This is Walter Koenig, everybody.
Hey, Walter.
AKA Chekhov.
Yeah.
Walter, when you finished your run, would you be so kind as to sit down and have a conversation with me about your years on Star Trek?
Okay.
Oh, Walter Koenig, everybody.
Woo!
Coming up. Will Chekhov live long enough to help me find Mr. Spock? Just one more number. Shit. And I start training for the mother of all battles.
Spot me. Sniff it, Gorn! Sniff it!
Energy drink, banana?
Previously on Bring Back...
You're Walter Koenig! Banana! Walter Koenig!
I came upon Chekhov down in the local woods.
Oh, Walter Koenig, everybody!
Woo!
Oh, my.
He invited me back to his place, and I'm hoping he'll not only help me get to Spock, but give me his juice on the Enterprise.
Yuri Gagarin was on his way to make history.
When Star Trek hit our screens, the space race between the Soviet Union and the US was at its peak.
Khrushchev could hardly control his emotion. Let the capitalist countries catch us up.
I believe that this nation should commit itself to achieving the goal before this decade is out, of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to the Earth.
Okay, engine stop.
As the Americans made history, the Cold War was intensifying.
The Eagle has landed. That's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
Mr. Chekhov, give him a full spread of photon torpedoes.
Aye, Captain.
Rumor had it that Bigwig Chekhov was introduced to show the two nations could get on.
As far as the instruments can make out, there is nothing else down there that's alive.
But most people couldn't see past his dodgy accent. Amazingly, it was his way with words that won him the audition.
So I came in and I read, and it was an interesting reading.
It was a very serious scene, but they said they wanted me to read it with a Russian accent. So I saw that the ship is about to disintegrate. It's about to explode. So I assumed that that was the intention with which they wanted me to read the part. So I said, "Captain, the ship is about to explode. What are we going to do?" And after I got done with what I thought was, a riveting performance, they said, "Yeah, but could you make it funny?" Funny? Funny? Where is the funny in these lines, But deciding that the part was more important than my artistic integrity, I said, "Captain, guess what? The ship is about to blow up." And they loved it. And actually, that was the line reading that got me the part on Star Trek.
In this classic scene...
Mr. Chekhov.
Chekhov is shown working his Moscow magic on the ladies.
"What can I do, Captain? You know we're always supposed to maintain good relations with the natives."
It was a maneuver the network desperately wanted to replicate off-screen, hoping the randy Russian would attract young women to the show.
"Young lady..."
"Yes, Ike."
I think they were trying to cover all the bases. And they had already acquired the more mature fans, and now I think they were looking for younger fans. And they had seen the success that the Monkees had had with Davy Jones. They wanted that look, that, mop-haired kind of look. And as a matter of fact, I did look somewhat like Davy Jones, an older Davy Jones, but somewhat like Davy Jones.
Series 2 showed the crew as one big happy family, but behind the scenes, the new arrival was having the opposite effect with some of the cast, including George Takei.
"They brought in this new actor and gave him all the lines that were originally written for me. I was raging. And then, insult upon injury, they had us share the same dressing rooms."
George said that he felt some resentment and that it was apparent on the set that he was a little angry with me. It wasn't apparent to me.
Really?
If indeed he felt that way, he did a very good job of hiding it.
"Do you think anyone was out to get you on Star Trek?"
Bill Shatner, blah, 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 blah.
Mr. Shatner? Do you think he had a problem because all of a sudden, he's Captain Kirk, new character comes in, young, good-looking, huge wig, but there to appeal to...
Well, we had that in common. But I must quickly add that so is this, okay? So I can throw stones.
He's a fascinating character.
He's an extraordinary guy. He's very much a contradiction. He can be extremely warm and congenial. In fact, he was the life of the show. But there are other things that were less pleasant, very singular approach to the work, a very much a self-involved approach to the work, which inadvertently, there were times when our roles suffered as a consequence.
"Captain."
"Mr. Chekhov."
"Captain."
"Mr. Chekhov, as you were."
Chekhov was famously one of the few characters in the series to stand up to Captain Kirk.
"Got a personal score to settle with the Klingons."
But out of costume, Walter wasn't quite as outspoken when it came to challenging Shatner over his on-set influence.
"We never said it. That's the thing. We never said it. Another actor, another star, might have been sensitive to the actors, and understood that there should be some balance here somewhere. But he said, "But you guys were supporting actors," he said to me. He says, you're supporting actors. You're not the stars." He did not know how disgruntled we were because nobody ever said it. And why didn't we say it? Because in the back of each of our minds was the possibility that as powerful as he was and as important to the production as he was, if he said, "I don't want Koenig," it could conceivably happen.
Walter, it's been an absolute pleasure talking to you. Can you help me find Spock? Just a number I can call him.
Okay, it's 4... Wait, 4, 2, 3...
Just one more number! Just one more number! Oh, shit! Chekhov! Chekhov! Walter, please help me find Spock.
I'll give him a call, talk to him, see how he's feeling, and get back to you.
Great, thanks very much.
Sure.
Thanks a lot, okay.
Sure.
So I'll see myself out?
Oh, yeah.
Okay.
I'm just going to take a little nap.
Yeah. Thanks, Walter.
Cheery bye.
By the end of season 2, the viewing figures had fallen, so the network decided to cut it.
axe it, nix it. The only reason it came back for season three was thanks to a huge letter-writing campaign by these guys. The Trekkies. Look at their faces. They love it.
That third season ensured that a red shirt named Lieutenant Leslie became a legend.
Captain.
Thanks to scenes like this one, the notorious redshirts have earned a place in the Popular Culture Hall of Fame. Week in, week out, wearing one meant you were guaranteed never to get a happy ending. And because of the popularity of these often unintentionally hilarious deaths, redshirt became a buzzword in the language of sci-fi.
Redshirt. You ever watch Star Trek?
So much so, it was even honored in one of today's biggest TV hits, Lost.
Now we go down to the planet with the main guys, the captain and the guy with the pointy ears. They always wore red shirts, and they always got killed.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Sounds like a piss poor captain.
Lieutenant Leslie, a.k.a. Eddie Paskey, was the ultimate redshirt, the only one who famously avoided the Grim Reaper, so he's next on my hit list.
The thing about Eddie Paskey is that he actually appeared in more Star Trek episodes than both Walter Koenig, Chekhov, and even George Takei, Mr. Sulu. So we need to find him, and if he's still alive, ask him what life was like on board the Starship Enterprise.
Ed is now a retired car mechanic, and we've wrangled an address from a bunch of local grease monkeys. Fingers crossed, he still lives there.
Is this it?
Oh, shh, dog. All right, stand back. Hello there, I'm so sorry to bother you. My name's Justin. I'm looking for Eddie Paskey.
He's actually at his daughter's salon right now. We're
okay.
Fixing it up, getting ready to open up a hair salon.
Oh, could you tell me where that is by any chance?
Sure.
That's right. Right, this should be it. So there's the service slip to the salon. There you go, that's it. Get ready, boys, we're gonna do this. All right, let's go. Come on, Sammy. Come on, Ben. Excuse me, do you know where I'll find Eddie Paskey? Indoors? Thank you. Watch out, it's wet. It's very wet. Excuse me, please, I'm looking for Eddie Paskey.
I'm Eddie.
You played Lieutenant Leslie in Star Trek. We had a tip-off that you were here. I've come all the way from the UK.
Okay.
I'm a big Star Trek fan. I'm doing a show for Channel 4 television in England called Bring Back Star Trek. Mm. I'm trying to track down and reunite as many of the original cast members as possible. And I was just wondering if you wouldn't be able to, wouldn't mind dropping them up.
Yeah, I think I could.
For an hour or two and having a chat with me about your time on Star Trek.
All right. Okay.
Would that be okay?
Yeah, I'm amazed.
Really?
Yeah.
Eddie Paskey, everybody. Eddie, red shirt, red car, what's going on? You're tempting fate. You're tempting fate.
If we ever make it to his house alive, I want to find out from Eddie how he managed to become the only red shirt who never died.
When that red shirt guy was going to be killed, I was gone. I was out. I was getting Bill a cup of coffee or some damn thing.
You were aware of the red shirt thing.
Exactly.
So they're going, who gets to wear the red shirt today? And you're thinking, not me, I'm going to make some coffee.
Exactly.
Because I know if I put on that red shirt, I'm going to get it.
Eddie's luck could only last so many episodes, and he was eventually finished off by a cloud of magic mist.
They fall down dead. And they, of course, put this pale white makeup on, and they shot me down.
What?
Dead. And you'll find every red corpuscle gone from their body.
I look like an ice cube.
Miraculously, Eddie was alive the following week with no explanation whatsoever because the scene where Bones saves his life was cut.
Bones brought me back. It was, you know, go back up to sick bay and gave me a shot of Kickapoo Joy Juice.
Kickapoo Joy Juice?
Whatever, you know.
Is that what he was dishing out?
Yes.
Kickapoo Joy Juice.
You gotta watch that stuff.
You're still taking that stuff? I'd like to try some of that.
Yeah.
What is it, up the nose, or how'd you take that Kickapoo Joy Juice?
No, he used that fancy hypodermic needle.
But were you thinking to yourself, hang on a minute, I've just died?
No.
I'll keep quiet.
No.
Hopefully no one will notice.
No,
I'll just come back next week. No one will know.
I wasn't thinking like that.
I'll tell you why.
But after that, I did. I wasn't going to be killed anymore, I'll tell you that.
Every time Eddie had extra action or dialogue, he made more money.
Get back to your stations.
I'm sorry, sir. We're all trapped.
So the stars of the show use their clout to build the part of Lieutenant Leslie in scenes like this to make a difference to his pay packet.
This is mutiny, mister.
Yes, sir. It is.
They realized we as stand-ins made our extra money when we did something a little bit different. So they would purposely bring us into a set anytime I'm in direct contact with the star.
Whenever you're ready, Mr. Leslie.
Leaving orbit, sir.
That's another $90 at that time. They were going to try to help the old family make a little extra money.
There's just 3 days to go to my reunion, and I've been officially warned off harassing William Shatner. I don't want to end up someone's bitch in prison, so I'm going to have to leave him alone and accept I'll be playing his part in my remake of one of the series' most defining moments. Kirk's fight with the fearsome Gorn has become one of the most iconic and popular scenes in the history of Star Trek. So much so that when this Turkish ripoff was made, it not only recreated the world of the Enterprise in loving detail, even down to Shatner's hair, but paid a terrifyingly realistic homage to the mother of all battles. Uhura wanted an eye-popping, heart-racing climax, and I'm gonna give her one. With time against me, I'm now buffing and polishing myself up like a Greek god to take on the most fearsome creature in the galaxy.
Spot me! Spot me! This is the Gorn. Take a good, long, hard look at this face. Look into those evil, piercing, demonic eyes. The cold, dead, black eyes of a shark. This is what I have to fight. And I'll fight it. Even though I know this thing could rip me apart. Like a squirrel.
Sniff it, Gorn! Sniff it!
I can barely look at it. I don't think it makes me any less of a man to tell you that when I look at this thing, it shits me up.
To make this fight truly authentic, I'm on the trail of the stuntman inside the lizard costume who so magnificently brought the creature to life, Bobby Clark.
We're in cowboy country. We've gone broke back for this one, Sammy. Hold on to your ass. You smell that, Sammy? That's hardcore Gorn, and I want me some.
But the address I've got for him is over 10 years old, so heaven knows who or what I'll find living out here in the middle of nowhere.
Hey, nice and easy, Sammy. Don't want to get shot.
For all I know, this place could be full of intermarried cousins off their tits on moonshine who'll shoot me in the face as soon as look at me.
Easy, Sam. Well, there's a house, so that's got to be it, hasn't it? All right, there's a dog. That's not a good sign for me. Did you see that guy pop out then? Did you see that guy pop out? Excuse me, please, are you Bobby Clark by any chance?
Yeah, who are you?
My name's Justin. I've come all the way from England, Bobby, making a show for Channel 4 television. It's called Bring Back Star Trek. You were the Gorn.
Yeah, I was.
You were the Gorn monster in my favourite ever episode. And I was just wondering, we've come all this way. Is there any chance we could maybe sit down and have a conversation about being in Star Trek?
We can do that.
Are you sure?
Yeah.
Can I come up? Is that all right?
Well, you can come up, I can come down.
Oh, great. Okay, maybe you want to come down, maybe?
All right.
Bobby, it's really nice to meet you.
My pleasure
to meet you.
My pleasure.
Oh, my goodness me. Bobby Clark, a.k.a. the Gorn, everybody. It's the Gorn.
Glad to see y'all.
Bobby, let's break the scene down. I'd like to talk about some of my favourite moments, starting with the big branch.
I'm glad you reminded me of this. And he threw his away because I've got a stick 5 feet long and he's got a stick 2 feet long. My stick is 4 inches around and his stick is an inch round. So, yeah, he threw it away.
He felt inferior. It's a man thing. He had an inferiority complex about the size of his stick. He thought, I can't compete with this being from another planet. That's the biggest stick I've ever seen. Get rid of it.
Oh, yes.
Well, then we move to the rocks. He throws a rock at you, just hits your chest, nothing. You don't even flinch.
Wasn't that something?
I know.
Well, that rock probably would have weighed Maybe 20 pounds, if it was a real rock. It'd make you move, though, but I didn't move. I just stood there like that.
I just thought to myself, when I watch it now, I just think, Shatner, you've got to get a bigger rock.
He couldn't throw anything heavier.
Bobby Clark, I've got a massive thing to ask you. This is a big favor. You ready for this?
I don't know. What is it?
I would like to recreate my favorite scene from Star Trek with me as Captain Kirk. You are, of course, the Gorn, and let's get it on, because I've got some trouble to bring to your door. What are you going to do about it?
You want to do it?
Yes, please.
You really want to do it?
Bobby.
It's going to be a little warm, going to be a little miserable, and there might be some people running around it, but I don't give a darn. All right, let's go do it.
Let's get it on. Bobby Clark, everybody, come on. AKA the Gorn. Woo!
Check out my ringtone.
Coming up.
I love your hot buttons.
Chekhov's got me a hot date with Spock.
Yeah, that's great news, Walter. Thank you so much.
And it's time for my reunion. But will anyone come aboard my spaceship?
I can't fly the ship and twiddle the knobs and push the buttons. I can't do any of that by myself.
I'm nearing the end of my mission to bring back the most influential space adventure in TV history.
Nichelle Nichols!
Uhura said she'd make an appearance at the reunion on one condition.
If I come, it's got to be very special.
So I'm going to recreate my favourite scene with all the latest CGI.
That's rubbish! It's like Prisoner Cell Block H! Do I look like vinegar tits?
Sulu couldn't resist my invitation.
I love your hot buttons.
Walter and his wig will both be there.
Chekhov! Chekhov!
While the Gorn is itching for a knuckle supper.
Sniff it, Gorn! Sniff it!
Ah! Yeoman Rand is unavailable.
I can guarantee that I would not mention the syrup.
And Captain Kirk said an absolute definite no. But I've just been woken up with some good news.
Leonard's people called. We've got... He wants to see you.
Is this wind up?
Walter Koenig has pulled a blinder and got me a very precious 30 minutes with Leonard Nimoy, a.k.a. Spock.
All right, guys.
Leonard will grant me an audience, but I need to get to his house quick sharp before he leaves town on business. From what we've heard, first impressions with his royal Spockness mean everything.
All right. My breath stinks. That's what I'm talking about. That's what I'm talking about. Spock's gonna have to smell this. I haven't washed. I stink. I haven't had a poo.
Take a dump at Spock's place.
I'm not gonna take a dump at Spock's place. What are you talking about? Is this it? Sam?
I'm not sure. This is it.
Is it?
House. Yeah.
Are you serious?
Yeah, this is it. He said that we can't film outside his house though, so you've got to kill the camera. That's it.
We're at Mr. Spock's house. This is Mr. Spock's garden. Mr. Spock has just made me this coffee. Trouble is, we've only got about 30 minutes to set up. We're only allowed to just film the interview here, nothing else. But do you know what? That's good enough for me. I'm in Mr. Spock's backyard, and what Mr. Spock says goes.
Hello, hello.
Hello there.
Hello.
Leonard Nimoy, everybody.
Leonard Nimoy played the green-blooded, half-human, half-Vulcan Mr. Spock. Network execs were initially worried that the character looked too devilish and frightening for viewers, so they asked for his ears and eyebrows to be made to look more human. The colour of his skin also had to be changed.
Well, the original idea that Gene Roddenberry had was that Spock should be red. Literally red. The problem was that in 1966, when we went on the air, there was still a lot of black and white TV sets operating, and the red just went totally black. So Spock became a black person, and that wasn't the intention. So we did away with the red and went to this yellowish look.
Despite the network's initial fears, it was Spock's distinctive appearance which helped make him so popular with viewers.
Tell me, did you happen to make any comment about those ears?
In this famous scene, his shipmates are obsessed with one thing.
But I did get the distinct impression she found them the most attractive human characteristic of all.
Something Nimoy couldn't escape in the outside world.
She really liked those ears? Captain.
The easy press thing for the journalist was Leonard Nimoy, he of the pointed ears. Or Spock, the one with the funny ears, you know. And I'd get invitations to come places and bring your funny ears, you know. For an actor that took himself seriously, it was a little difficult. Could I come without the ears? Would it be okay, you know? But we got past that.
Oh, my goodness me.
Wow. And these are the last ears you ever wore?
Well, no, that's the last pair that I wore on the series. But this is very precious to me.
Can I have them?
Which would make
Spock also gave the world the Vulcan greeting, which, like his ears, would become an icon of the series and adopted by fans around the world.
Live long and prosper.
It was Nimoy himself who introduced the symbol based on a traditional Hebrew gesture.
This is the shape of a Hebrew letter in the Hebrew alphabet. It's called the Shin. And it makes that SH sound. So it's the first letter in the word Shaddai, which is a Hebrew name for the Almighty.
Which I can't do. Look.
What about your other hand? Can you do it? Same problem.
Just the same.
Well, all right.
But okay. I have to spend 8 minutes.
All right. You have to spend some time working at that.
Can you just bust it out whenever...
Yeah, either hand, yeah.
The greeting had its first outing in this scene featuring fellow Vulcan, T'Pau. What viewers didn't realise was that out of shot, she was struggling to flick him the V's.
And she had the same problem that you do, by the way.
Really?
Yeah, she couldn't quite get there. She held her hand prepared, held it in shape with her other hand, out of sight of the camera. So when it was time, she was ready and she lifted it up and went like that.
What I love about that is that's something that you took from the Jewish church, mm-hmm. but now it crosses religions, crosses cultures, and everybody, regardless of culture, regardless of religion, they're all doing that. Did you just see that?
I knew you could do that. I knew it.
Normally I have to do that.
I'm impressed.
Thank you.
You've come to the right place.
I'm in the presence of Spock, and now I can just do it.
And that wasn't the only special thing Spock could do with his hands. This scene, where a good Kirk is fighting a bad Kirk, is when viewers first got to see the legendary Vulcan neck pinch.
It was written that he hits him over the head with the butt of his phaser and knocks him out. And I said, I don't think that's appropriate. So I said to Bill, this is what I'm going to do. I'm going to come up behind you and do this. And Bill did that and dropped it. I didn't want Spock involved in brawls, so I just found this way of dealing with it very simply and very quickly. So there's something on your left shoulder there.
Really?
Yeah, and come over to the left side, and then you're gone, you know. That's it.
For Leonard, spending so much time in Vulcan character was beginning to affect his home life.
Being in that character, 12, 14 hours a day, my personality changed.
In what way?
Well, I became more rational. I became more logical. I became more thoughtful. I became less emotional. I drifted towards that Spock-like kind of being. I could feel it on the weekends. Saturday, after working 5 days as Spock, Saturday I would still be in the Spock zone. Sundays, by about 3 or 4 o'clock in the afternoon, it would start to go away.
By the third series, budget cuts hit the show and led to increasingly ridiculous storylines like this one, where Spock's brain is stolen and he has to be operated by remote control. As a direct result, viewers switched off in droves, and for the cast, the dodgy plots and sets were a clear sign that the end of the show was nigh.
I never felt we were getting network support, never. They gave us a terrible time slot, and the show died a dismal death, and I frankly was relieved, because we're not doing good shows, we don't have an audience. Why run this thing into the ground? We've done our best. Let's leave it, let it go.
What do you think is the legacy of the original Star Trek?
Star Trek told us that we were all part of one civilization. And wouldn't it be wonderful if we could find a way to communicate with each other without being demanding and insisting that you be more like me? If we could find a way to enjoy each other's characteristics and understand and appreciate each other. And I think that's the major legacy of the show.
Leonard Nimoy, a.k.a. the actor who played Mr. Spock, live long and prosper.
And the same to you. Thank you very much.
Leonard Nimoy, everybody.
That's it. It's all over. I can't believe what I've been through for the last 10 days. I've had Sulu biting my buns, Kirk's dogs wanting to rip off my plums, and Uhura trying to slip me the tongue. Now it's down to business, and time for this captain to take to the skies and fly. It's reunion day, and over at the studios, my CGI spaceship is finally ready.
Oh, come on. The USS Collins. I love it. I've got a window. I can see Uranus, Sammy. It's exactly what I wanted to see. Look at that. Coming monitors. A bit of space porn. That's cheeky.
I order you to make love to me.
Actually, it's a bit wrong. Let's watch that later on. Oh! Music television. Bilbo. Bilbo Baggins. It's good. It's all good, you boys. I'm happy. I've got a ship. Just need to make it a starship. I need a crew.
There's no sign of anyone. My shipmates were due over half an hour ago, and this liftoff is starting to look more like a crash landing.
It's rude, it is rude. But I'm just, into a lot of trouble. I can't fly the ship and twiddle the knobs and push the buttons. I can't do any of that by myself. I could maybe do that, but I need, whilst I'm doing that, someone else needs to do that.
My space launch is now an hour late, and it looks like it's going to be me enjoying the astronaut food all on my own.
How long are they going to be? How long are they going to be? How long are they going to be? No? Anyone? Anyone? I've gone to all this trouble. I've got a starship. This is a fucking USS Collins. I mean, I'm quite honest with you, this is a piss take. All right, cut it. Cut it. Let's get the CGI out, all right? Lose this, all of this. Let's hit the phones. Start making some calls. Let's get on the phones. It's not working.
At the moment, I'm a lonely captain on an empty ship, and I desperately need a number two on the bridge, or my Star Trek reenactment will be the biggest disaster in the galaxy.
Hey, hello? Yeah? Is it? All right. All right, brilliant. All right, yeah. All right, call me if you get anything else. All right, love, thank you. It's back on, fire her up. CGI, G, drop it back in. Well done, mate, it's back on, come on.
The star date is right now, and with some of the original crew ready to take their places on board, I can finally bring back the Trek.
I'm Captain Justin L. Collins, and I am living every Trekkie's dream. Fasten your seatbelts. Uhura! Do that thing you do.
Hailing frequencies open, Captain Collins.
It's cheeky, little minx. You've still got it. Sulu, you with me?
Aye, aye, Captain.
What was that, Chekhov?
Your Captain, the ship is about to explode. What are we going to do?
I don't want to hear that kind of talk, Chekhov. It's not going to happen on my watch. Mr. Sulu, knock that off. It's unseemly. I've got unfinished business. I'm going to fight the Gorn. Beat me down.
The most terrifying thing I've ever seen.
You want it? Bring it. I'll fuck you up. Step up to this. What's up? Oh! Oh! Shut up, Gorn! Shooters. Shit. Suck on this! Oh, ooh, yeah. Yeah, still got it. His ass. Kirk had 5 years to boldly go where no man had gone before. I've had just 10 days, and I've brought back Star Trek. And as for the Gorn, he's Gorn. He's a Gorner. Mission accomplished. Shall we get some space cakes?
Yes.
Space cakes?
Space cakes.
Yeah? Let's get the space gates. Come on. Oh, man. Back is killing me.
Tomorrow night, a former nurse heads for Dundee, and as a childless woman, she's in for a culture shock. The Secret Millionaire at 9. Something else for Trekkies next tonight. Patrick Stewart meets his doppelganger. A genetic matter, perhaps? Star Trek Nemesis.